again. Are you ready for a midweek recharge? Let's go to Bible study.
Hello and welcome to Midweek Word here at Nations for Community Church. I'm Minister Tonya Richardson, and I'm so excited that you decided to join us this evening. Tonight, I will be talking to you from the focus of more likes and phony love as it relates to our presence as children of God, as children of the light, and our responsibility during a social media age. But before we dig into our word, let's start with prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We honor you, Father, for this evening. Father, we know that if it had not been for you on our side, we don't know where we would be. Father, we don't even know how we would have made it throughout the day, Father, because we know that it was you who was directing us, who was guiding us. Yes, Father, I think we made some mistakes today, Father, but we ask right now in the name of Jesus that you would forgive us of anything, Father, that we have said, done, or thought that was displeasing in your sight, Father. Father, we come to you because we want to get it right with you, Lord. We don't want nothing to break our fellowship with you, Father. So, Father, we ask right now, Lord, that you would just open up our hearts so that we could hear your word, that it will be applied to our situation and our lives and the reality of the things that we deal with on a day-to-day basis. So, Father, I just thank you right now for the people of God who has tuned in. For it is in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. The scripture that we'll be focusing on this evening is from John chapter 6, verses 14 through 15. I will be using other scriptures or supporting scriptures throughout tonight's study, but our focal scripture is again, John chapter 6, verses 14 through 15, and I'll be reading from the New International Version. And it reads, "After the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, 'Surely this is the prophet who is come into the world.' Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself." Social media validation continues to be on the rise. Who I am and how I view myself is wrapped up and shaped by expressive emojis and comments from people, most people that I don't even know, and some I will never meet. Is that a narrative that you find yourself in or have found yourself in from day to day as you interact with social media? Well, tonight, I want us to answer the question, what is the responsibility of a child of God amongst darkness? So tonight, I thought that we would answer this question through the lens of social media, where we are and where we usually are confronted with more likes and phony love. Social media, like most things in this world, is a tool, and tools can be used for good and for bad, to lift us up or to tear us down. A knife in itself is a very productive tool. It's productive in the right hand, with the right intention. Or a knife can be a destructive tool. It could be used as a weapon in the wrong hands and with the wrong intentions. The same thing that can be argued about the knife can be argued about social media. It can be a very productive tool for connection and content with great intention, but it can also be a destructive tool depending on whose hand it is in and their purpose or their intent in using it. There are three challenges with social media that the Christian must be aware of that I want to share with you tonight. The number one challenge with social media is that it expands and it embraces negativity. It is argued that 88% of what goes viral is negative, and it never brings any glory to the kingdom of God. Positive platforms, however, have smaller followings. They don't have the large followings like negative content or negative focus posts. And even those platforms try, even the positive platforms try to bring some edge to it or some drama to it so that their posts can capture the attention of those who are scrolling or tweeting on Facebook or Twitter. Because memes like God loves you or God made a way are not widely viewed by others. Because without drama or some sort of negative news, social media actually stalls. It's only when it's something ratchet or when it's something that doesn't glorify God that it is at its peak. Another challenge of social media is that it caters to anonymous immaturity. Anonymous immaturity. There are people who say things on social media that they would never say face to face with someone. One of the biggest issues on Facebook, or has been on Facebook for some time, is this thing called cyberbullying. It's amongst kids and it's amongst teenagers as body shaming. Then, it now, even today, it has expanded through moms and parent shaming. I've come to know this, that anybody can be hard on the other side of the phone, or anybody can be a gangster on the other side of a keyboard. Following people and making threats can be common when there will be no threat coming back at you. However, I was raised in an era, I don't know about you, but I was raised in an era that says you have to say it to my face. But that is not the case today. We like to say things behind a keyboard or behind a screen or behind somebody's back. People's immaturity is fueled by what they get to do behind the scene or behind social media. The third challenge of social media is this. It creates an inauthentic sense of identity, beauty, and security. Who I am is invested in the hands of a crowd of people who I will never know. Or what we see as a woman as beautiful, we see it as it is identified on Instagram. And even this sense of security that we have it in certain numbers of followers or certain numbers of likes to confirm who we really are today. And it becomes, to most of our the issues that we face, it becomes a very destructive tool for people who rest their identity in the crowds or their worth in the comments of individuals, again, that they will never meet. A people that they will likely never know, they have given authority to determine how you should feel about yourself. People who don't even feel good about their own selves are commenting how you should feel about yourself. So if social media is primarily negative, remember, approximately 88% of what goes viral is negative. What is our role or our responsibility as children of light or children of God within this type of environment? Well, tonight I want you to consider some questions as it pertains to your life in Christ and the use of a social media platform. And those three questions are, why am I or why do I use social media? What is my intention or motivation for this tool? And last, am I allowing this tool to shape my identity? What makes John chapter 6 so relevant to us today is that it addresses how Jesus dealt with mass followers and the popularity of the crowds. So pertaining to social media, the first thing Jesus teaches us about our responsibility among darkness is here in chapter 6. Jesus arguably is at the height of his ministry. His popularity is at the peak in the eyes of the people of Galilee. There are two events that are recorded in the book of John that increase Jesus' following. One was the raising of Lazarus, John writes in chapter 12 that the raising of Lazarus from the dead was so powerful, and so many people followed Jesus after that, that the Pharisees, the haters, wanted to kill Jesus. The only other miracle that comes close to that type of popularity for Jesus is recorded here in John chapter 6 with the feeding of the 5,000. Think about it. 5,000 men, not including women and children, were following Jesus. Arguably, this was actually, if we include the women and the children, 12,000 people had witnessed Jesus feeding them from a few little fish and a little bit of bread. That's really the word, a word for somebody, you know, tonight. I really feel that God doesn't need much to multiply what he has called you to do in your life. You may say, God, I don't have much to work with. God, I don't have much education. God, I don't have much experience. God, I don't have many resources. God, I don't make the money that other people make. I can't get the homes that other people get. But God doesn't need all that you have, because even though you have little, God has much. And all he wants to do is multiply what is in your hands by you attaching it what's in his hands. And the word of God tells us that he owns 1,000 cattle upon 1,000 hills. So God really doesn't need what you have, but he'll take what you have in order to multiply your life. So we need to understand that God always works in multiplication. He never works in addition. If he did, it would take us a long time to build up what we need to build up in God. So if we work and understand that God works in multiplication, you can come with a little. It's what the word of God tells us, that it's only by the grain of a mustard seed that the mustard seed faith that we need. So if it's just a grain of a mustard seed and that's all that you need to get what you what God has placed in your life, or what God has for your life, if that's all that is required from you, that means that God doesn't need a lot. Because what God wants to do is allow you to see that it is him that is working. It has nothing to do with your education, has nothing to do with your background. It has nothing to do with how much money you make. It's all about who God is and what he looks to do in your life. So I hope, even in that, that somebody is encouraged to know that it don't take a lot for God to do a lot in your life. So John writes that when the crowd, after they had eaten, saw that Jesus did this sign, what they tried to do at that time was rush Jesus to make him a king. The Bible says that when Jesus saw the crowd coming after him to make him a king, he escaped. He left a mass of people that wanted to elevate him. Why does Jesus avoid the intent of the crowd? What causes him to avoid the approval and the affirmation of the masses? Jesus' response shows us that numbers can be deceptive, that more likes and more loves doesn't necessarily mean more devotion and more loyalty, that sometimes you have got to get out of the way or get away from fake admiration and fickle approval of the large crowds. So why doesn't numbers or why don't numbers matter to Jesus? Why doesn't it matter? Or why did he try to get away from these followers? The number one thing I believe, the reason that Jesus tried to get away, was that crowds cannot confirm purpose. Look at verse 15 again. Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and to make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. The problem here is the crowd wants to make Jesus a king. Jesus understood his purpose. He did not come to be a king. He came to be a savior. If he allowed the crowd to determine his purpose, he would have tried to be something God did not send him to be, which would have limited his calling. So Jesus shows us that large followings don't mean that that's God's purpose for your life. that the desire or the promotion of the crowd doesn't mean that is what God has called you to. Because followers, large crowds, will always try to push you into arenas that are a benefit to him or to them, but prove to be a distraction or destruction to the purpose that God has for your life. So the question or the challenge for us tonight is, are we trying to be something other than what God has called us to be? Are we walking in what God has called us to be? Or are we just trying to be what people want us to be? Are we missing our broader purpose because we keep allowing people to box us into settling for what looks good right now, but not what God has for our future? Are we getting caught up by voices and applauses of the day while missing what God is trying to take you through to make you bigger than what you've been, stronger than what you are, and greater than what you can be in your tomorrow? Because sometimes the latter is never popular. The majority doesn't always rule. Crowds, numbers, followers, friends, more likes and more loves can be phony and tend to push us into things that we do not have the discernment, or the people who are trying to push us into these things usually don't have the discernment of whether or not that was God's purpose for your life. We have to be careful seeking approval of crowds, thinking that the more claps and the more likes and the more retweets, the more we must be moving where God wants us to be. And that is not so. The crowd can absolutely deceive you into thinking that you are all right, that you are anointed, that you are doing this, that what you are doing is within what God has for you. Convincing you that this is your purpose, this is your goal, this is who God called you to be. But know this, again, crowds cannot confirm purpose. There are too many Christians pushed into places too early. They're pushed into places that their character has not been yet developed to walk in. So what they are ultimately called to is place, or they're ultimately getting into places too quickly that they have ultimately been called to, but they've gotten into too quickly. So their gift here is that we ought to, so they're gifted people. And it's not saying that that's not what God has called you to. You're gifted for it, but you have not been developed in your character to walk in it as of yet. So don't let other people push you into places that you know that God has at this moment restrained you from. Listen to God's voice. Move in the direction that he has for you, and don't allow the demand of the crowd to persuade you. Secondly, Jesus avoids the crowd, not only because crowds cannot conform or confirm purpose, but also because crowds can be fickle and they can be unreliable. The word of God shows us through Jesus' ministry that you cannot count on the crowd. You can't count on followers because they are fickle, then they will turn on you in a minute. And if anybody knows this, Jesus knows this. Remember in the book of Matthew, there was a Sunday that Jesus is coming into Jerusalem. There's this huge crowd that's gathered around because the reason they are gathered is because of Jesus' reputation, his teaching, and the works that have preceded him. People have heard about Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. They heard about Jesus feeding the 5,000. They heard about Jesus making the blind to see and the lame to walk. They heard about dead being raised again and demons being cast out of people. There have been tweets and retweets over all of Instagram and posts on Facebook about his miracles, quotes from his teachings that have been placed on t-shirts and tote bags. Now he's arrived in Jerusalem and the crowds gather shouting his name. What they're saying, Hosanna and Hosanna. That was on Sunday. By Friday morning, outside of Pilate's window, you hear another crowd gathered together. And some of these are the same crowd that were there on Sunday, who were there shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna. They are now shouting, kill him, crucify him, because crowds are fickle. When his purpose became evident, the crowds grew smaller because Jesus wasn't born to be an earthly king. He was born to die so that he would be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He was born that he would be our heavenly king and our everlasting king, in which all things would come subject to him, not just in this earth, but above the earth and beneath the earth. See, we see through Jesus' experience that numbers can be very unreliable, as they don't affirm who you really are. Neither do they acknowledge who God has created you to be. They don't point you in the right direction for your purpose. Now again, I'm not saying that social media is all bad. Remember, it is a tool. There is purpose for it, and yet we must be aware and mindful of the intent in using it. Because there can be something positive, but we got to remember that it is primarily negative. So, knowing that, what do we need to do as Christians, as children of the light, when we are exposed to darkness, when we are exposed to this negativity? Matthew 5:16 tells us that, let our light shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your heavenly Father. So what do we do, or what should we do, to point others to Jesus Christ in a social media era? What are people seeing when they view your social media page? How can we become better stewards of this tool called social media? Well, first, we don't give into the crowd, and which we learned already. But secondly, our responsibility as Christians amongst the darkness is to don't make your activity an idol. The question here in this point is, has social media become an idol in your life? Remember, one of the very first commandments God gave the children of Israel when they came out of bondage was, you will have no other gods before me. Don't put anything before me. Don't put any god or gods or idols in front of who I say or what I have called you to be and who I am to you. That is part, really, of our walk in the Lord. What defines actually our relationship with him. And it is a covenant commitment that we make when we ask him to come into our lives, which is nothing. So that means that there should be nothing more important to us than God himself. No crowd, no people, no accolades. Nothing is more important to you and I than God. And there is nothing more important to him than you. And one of the things, and the reason that is if you are comfortable with anything or anyone having a higher priority or precedence in your life than your relationship with God, then I would suggest that something is slightly off in your Christianity. If you are willing to sacrifice your peace with God for anything else or someone else, something is slightly off in your walk with God. If you are willing to tell God no so you can tell her yes, then something is off with your walk with God. If you are willing to take a rest from doing God's work, but prefer to continue to hustle and grind to do man's work, then something is off in your relationship with God. So God, you have to understand, is either Lord of all, or he's Lord. He is not Lord at all. He is either first or he is nothing. God only knows one place, and that is first place. He only desires one position, and that is head of your life. So when you wake up in the morning, you know where I'm going with this. Before you even begin to thank God for another day, and the first thing you do is reach for your phone to check your social media posts, you have an idolatry problem. Think about it. If friends and followers, more likes and phony loves is more important than hearing God say, well done, then you have an idolatry problem. Paul said this in Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, and it reads, am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. In Paul's day, and even in our day, there are so many vices coming at Christianity that if he was trying to get on the side of people, he would not have gotten on the side of Christ. If being popular, gaining a large following, and increasing my numbers means that much to me, it would be hard for me to be a true servant of Jesus Christ. Why? Because I am willing to do whatever it takes to make it happen, even if what it takes displeases God. If I am willing to turn it up on social media for more likes and phony love at the expense of dimming my light in this world, then I can't be a servant of Jesus Christ, because to follow Christ requires a surrenderment or surrendering of self. Matthew 16 verse 24 says, Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. However, social media is not about self-denial. It is about self-promotion. Jesus said in Matthew 6, between the verses of 21 and verse 24, that we cannot serve two masters. Either you hate one and you love the other, or you are devoted to one and you would despise the other. When we read verses 21 through 23 of Matthew 6, then that leads into verse 24, when Jesus says this: what you fix your focus on determines what is in your heart, and what is in your heart will determine who and what you serve. I'm not really saying here that you ought to get off of social media. That's not the point of this discussion. What I am saying is you ought to pray before you get on social media in the morning. There's nothing really wrong with you checking who liked your post, nothing wrong with seeing who retweeted what you said. But how about reading scripture before you just get on social media? Put God first is all that I'm saying, so that your response and your motivation doesn't dim your light in this dark world. Matthew 6:33 says, if you put God first, all other things will be given unto you. If you put God first, everything else will line up. Generation Z may not know about anything about that. Millennials are just finding out. But on behalf of Generation X, on baby boomers, and even builders, there are still builders that are still among us today who have been there and who have done that will all testify that when you get God at the top of your priority list, everything else just falls into place. So has social media become an idol in your life? The final responsibility we have as Christians amongst the darkness that surrounds us is that we ought to be mindful of the fact of our third point, which is don't ruin your witness. My question to you is, what is your Christian witness on social media? Are we allowing the influences of the platform to taint our witness? Our witness is something we don't talk about a lot in church. But the fact that you are called to bear witness of Jesus Christ is extremely important. See, here is the problem. In church, we have always been told that evangelism and witnessing is associated with going out on a Saturday and handing out tracts and knocking on doors and getting into theological debates to prove to people that Jesus is Lord. Well, none of that is what we have been called to. We are called to bear witness, which means that when people look at us, when they see our lives, that our lives is supposed to testify to the presence of Jesus Christ. See, you don't have to understand all the details of theology. You don't have to understand the difference between Revelation and Genesis. Your life and how you live and your conduct and your character and in your conversation ought to bear witness to Christ's presence in your life. Paul wrote this in Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23. And he said this, I have the right to do anything you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. And this is where we hear, if I give you the King James version of it, all things are lawful, but not all things are expedient or helpful. What Paul is saying is, as a Christian, there is a lot that I can do, but not everything I do is beneficial, because some things that I can do as a Christian that I have the right to do can actually harm my witness. For example, the use of alcohol among believers. The only direction that the Word of God gives about alcohol is pertaining to excess of its indulgence. But if a glass of wine makes you tipsy, then for you, that is excess. So it is best for you not to drink wine. Now, I don't believe that if people, I don't believe this, I think I even been grown up to believe it, but I don't believe it because I have searched the scriptures for myself. So I don't believe that if you drink alcohol, that you are going to hell. But I do believe drinking alcohol in certain conditions and in certain environments can affect your witness. Because if drinking alcohol in the midst of those that don't know Christ, but know that you are a Christian, then drinking in front of them may not be expedient. If drinking alcohol causes you to lose all of your inhibitions, then drinking alcohol would not be expedient. If drinking alcohol is your mechanism to escape dealing with issues that God needs you to face, then drinking alcohol would not be expedient. If alcohol is something that you need to get through the day, then drinking alcohol would not be expedient for you. Because alcohol can become an idol and an addiction and an instrument that can hurt your witness. If you know others around you cannot handle seeing you with a glass of wine in your hand, then don't drink it in front of them. Now, I'm not encouraging you to be a closet drinker, but I am encouraging you to be mindful of the environment that you are in and the impact that you have on those who are around you, and govern yourself accordingly. So not to hurt your witness or to hurt others, to be acknowledged, nor does it what it does with others hurt your knowledge of the things of being lawful or what is lawful when it comes to the things of God. Because verse 24 of 1 Corinthians chapter 10 reads this, that no one should seek their own good, but the good of others. Which means that I can put that down, because if I put it down, then I know I'm not going to affect the witness or hurt the thoughts of other people. As we think about our witness and we take our witness seriously, and one of the things that we have to understand, that we live our life as if it is not about us. That is really what God is calling us to. That no, it's all about Him and it's not about us. That God, who called us to be a witness and to bear witness for Him, what He has called us is to put others first. Yes, I can do a lot of things, but God is saying, yeah, you can do it, and it's not going to hurt my relationship with you, but those things that you do can hurt your relationship with others, which then can also cause them to not serve me or do what they need to do in me. Because if anybody thinks that they know you, and one of the very first things that they don't know about you is that you are a Christian, I want you to remember what Jesus said in Mark chapter 8, verse 30, verse 38, which reads, if anyone is ashamed of me and my word in this sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him or shame of them when he comes. Again, if you live your life like you are ashamed of being a Christian, that is dangerous. So let me ask you this question. If Jesus was following you on social media, would he know you were following him in life? For some of us, the answer would be absolutely not, because there's nothing on our social media page that bears witness to Jesus Christ or gives a hint to his presence in our life. We are so caught up with showing people what we got going on that it smothers what God has put in us to show others about him. So the question that I have to ask you, especially to my sisters, because we post more selfies and pictures of ourselves than our brothers do. What is your intent in posting that selfie? Are you posting, or are your posts always provocative and revealing? Why is most of your posts about parties where you are turning it up and backing it up? I'm not here to judge you. I'm just here to tell you that doing that is not a good witness, that is immaturity. What's the purpose? Why is it more important to reveal your body versus revealing your heart for God? Are more likes and phony love more worth ruining your witness for God? Think about it. How much of your lives are you going to have to give an account for? Does social media count? Does what I post or retweet or reflect my life in Christ? Again, Jesus is following you on social media. So if Jesus is following you on social media, is there anything that lets him know that you are following him in life? That's our witness on the line. And so many people struggle with our Christianity, not because of what we speak, not because of what we teach, but because of how we live our lives and what they, and we are held accountable for what they see. And I'm not telling you that, you know, you have to be perfect. None of us are perfect, but an effort counts. Desiring to please God, that counts. Is your purpose for using social media misaligned with God's purpose for your life? Tonight, I am just encouraging you to dare to be different. If being a Christian means anything, it means sometimes we are absolutely different. And the challenge with social media is that it pushes us to blend in, to assimilate with this world, and we are called to stand out. We are not of the crowd. Yes, we are in this world, but we are not of this world. God has called us to stand out, to be absolutely different. Something about you ought to be strange. The Bible says in 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. The King James Version says we are a peculiar people. God, we are a people who God has called us to look strange. Your presence ought to make some people uncomfortable. It should make those in your presence rethink their position. People shouldn't want to blatantly sin in front of you and not care. But if they do, could it be the reason that they are sinning blatantly in front of you is because you doing the same things, because you are ruining your witness. So in my closing, our life is supposed to be unique and different. We're not meant to be chameleons in this world. You know what a chameleon is. It is an animal that has the ability to blend into whatever environment it is in. It is around, or whatever environment it is around. So if it is around something green, it turns green. If it's around something brown, it turns brown. If it's around something gray, it turns gray. And biologists would tell you that it is their defense mechanism or their survival technique. That because the chameleon doesn't have any fangs or claws or predatorial type of behavior, the way it survives is just blending in. So when it gets around something over here, or if it gets around something over there, whatever it gets around, it blends into, because it thinks it's saving itself. However, biochemically, every time a chameleon changes its color, every time a chameleon blends in, it takes 3 days off of its life. So every time it gets in a new environment, it blends in to survive. Actually, what it's doing is taking or killing itself. Every time it tries to fit in, every time it tries to blend in, every time we try to be popular, every time we are seeking the applause of other people on social media or in life, what we are actually doing could be killing our Christianity. We are called to be different. That's why we are dared to be different. Not telling you to get off social media. I'm not telling you to get off Instagram, but dare to be different in how you use it. Romans 12:2 tells us, "Do not be conformed in this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." What is our responsibility as a child of God amongst the darkness? It is to dare to be different. And my prayer tonight is that a mind has been renewed, that someone listening this evening may be challenged to get out to out of your way and do and start using social media differently. Start leveraging that platform in the way that it will glorify God. No longer posting selfies with you drinking or turning it up and toasting and doing all types of ratchetness. What I am calling for and what I am asking you for is not to dim your witness. Come out amongst this world and let your light so shine. Don't be conformed to this world, but be ye renewed by transforming your mind in Christ Jesus. Pray with me. God, our world has gifted us with the tool of social media. But God, as your children, as the people who are called by your name, God, I ask you today that you would help us, Lord, that you will give us a renewed mind, that when people see or follow us on social media, that they will see the light of Christ in us by the things that we post, by the comments that we make. God, create in us not only a new heart, but a right mind for you. Allow our witness not to be ruined. Allow us not to make the activity of social media, Father, an idol in our lives, and don't allow us to be persuaded by the crowd and by the numbers. God, I thank you for your people of God. God, I give you glory. God, I give you honor. It is in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. And if tonight that I am speaking to you, to someone online who may be right now struggling with that, and maybe the reason that you post the things that you have posted is because you're trying to get validation. You're trying to get people attention so that you can feel good about yourself. I want you to know tonight that God loves you, and he loves you just the way that you are, that you are more than enough. And I need you to remember that. And if tonight you don't think that you are, or you don't know the Christ that I am talking about, I encourage you to reach out to us. Go to www.nationsfor.org. Hit our contact us and complete the information, or put in comments tonight if you're watching us on social media or on Facebook that you need somebody to pray for you, and we will reach out to you. Be blessed. May God bless you and keep you. Thank you for joining us tonight on this Nations Forward Midweek Word. Have a blessed evening.
Thank you for joining us. We pray that this message was edifying and encouraging. To request more information about Nations Forward, visit nationsforward.org and click on the contact link. You can view information about our ministries, children and youth activities, give, download previous messages, and download our church app. We invite you to join us this Sunday for our remote life enrichment groups. Click on the LED icon on our homepage. Then join us on site or online at 10:15 a.m. for our worship celebration. Have a safe and blessed week.